Hi, it's Warren Huart here. I'm with the great Reid Shippen. How are you, mate?
Hey, Warren. How are you?
Good to see you again. We've obviously done the Skype interview.
Yes.
And I bumped into you. That was like the weirdest divine thing. I walk up to Larry Crane, and there you are, and there's Jason Lenning. It was like, I think that was probably like the hippest place to be at that moment.
Yeah. Anywhere around Larry Crane is the hippest place to be.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, he's just a magnet for coolness.
He's so cool that, when did that magazine come out? It's 20 years, isn't it? So, 96.
Really?
Yeah.
Jeez.
I remember it coming out. I remember going into a studio and picking up Tape Op. And just like, he was just interviewing all these kind of like left of center people. And he was talking about gear that I actually wanted to know about. Not that somebody was trying to sell me.
Yeah, totally.
And that's still what he does. He tells you about gear you want to know about.
Yeah, he's fantastic. I love Larry and everything that he does.
Yeah, it's just the whole aesthetic is just like makes perfect sense. Mm-hmm. And I know I always talk about it. People are probably bored of me saying it, but it's like, it's free.
I know, it's a no-brainer. We love you, Larry.
Yeah, it's free. So look, thanks very much for letting me come by and check out the studio.
Oh, my pleasure.
And we have similar things. I mean, I have a 40 channel. Wait, how many channels you got?
It's only 32 right now.
Right. Oh yeah, you got to buck it out. Mm. But you know, I wouldn't say we work in similar ways. We've talked about how we work, but we work similar-ish that we're running, you know, DAWs and we're running the console and we're also using outboard and stuff, which is a lot of fun.
It is a lot of fun.
Yeah. And that interview I did with you was from here and all I saw was bookshelves.
Sorry.
It's quite all right. But I was like, is he in the studio? Because it was like bookshelves. Now I see some records, a couple of gold records down there, a couple of platinum going on there. Got some Dierks Bentley there.
I think those were. I think my assistant put those out just to mess with me.
Right.
Oh. Because usually they're not displayed. Usually they're kind of in a pile. Sorry, Dierks. They're kind of in a pile. But
right.
I think he's just messing with me. The bookshelves were actually Richard Dodd's idea.
All roads come back to Richard Dodd.
Yeah, pretty much. Because he's genius.
When I was a kid. There was an album by Leo Sayer called Silverbird, and there was a single that was a hit called The Show Must Go On. So I'm a kid, like, you know, 7, 8, 9, and I'm looking on the back of albums, and it's my parents' album, and I go, you know, and it's like, blah, 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 produced, blah, 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 engineer, Richard Dodd.
Yeah.
So it's like, and that was like, when I was like 7 or 8 or 9, that was like my favorite song, and that was my favorite record. Because my parents, my dad only listened to classical and jazz music, so to have like one or two things that weren't that was like, eye-opening.
That's funny. My mom only listened to classical music. That's all I was allowed to listen to until I was like 9 or 10.
Which is great though, because I think it helps us develop an ear.
I think it does. I think
especially
it does.
Especially melody.
Yeah, and like pitch and all that stuff. Like it's I'm gonna call it an advantage. Let's just call it an advantage.
It's definitely an advantage.
Yeah.
It's blessed. And my dad had some jazz leaning, so we'd listen to like Ella Fitzgerald with Joe Pass playing guitar, which is just
mind-blowingly
unbelievable. Just one guy with a guitar backing this incredible jazz singer, and you never lose interest.
Yeah.
Yeah, my hairs are standing on end. really incredible. So you got so much beautiful gear in here, mate.
Thanks.
And we're not going to pick up the camera quite yet, but there's an omnipresser over there, which I'm going to wax lyrically about, which I discovered, actually, he'll know, from Indiana, being at Echo Park, because they have one there. Mike Wanchek's studio. Uh-huh. Probably sold it, unfortunately, because I know they were doing a bit of a fire sale with a lot of stuff over there.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it's great going to... you're probably the second or third person I've ever seen with one.
Really?
Yeah, people just don't know what it is.
Good.
Shh. Oh, okay.
Actually, edit this part out.
It's pretty insane. Yeah. What do you use it on?
I use it as a drum parallel.
Ah, yeah.
It does weird things to kick and snare. It
just kind of brings...
I don't know how it does. I don't even know what it does. It just sounds good.
Yeah. It's like a expander compressor on acid.
Yeah.
With some steroids.
You can do some really strange shit with it. So that's what's fun.
Yeah. Well, and that's, I think for what we do now, we're always looking for things, you know, I've said this a million times, but like everybody now has the world's greatest recorded Steinway.
Right.
Everybody has the best Bösendorfer recorded in Vienna in a concert hall. You know, when we were up and coming, that was like, wow, listen to how incredible that Steinway is. Now it's like, oh, listen to that generic, beautiful sample of a Steinway.
Right. Right.
So we're always looking for like wrong pieces of equipment, wrong something to give us some individuality.
Yeah, some character.
Character. Yeah.
That's what that stuff is best for.
Yeah, fantastic. So you got the SSL.
Mm-hmm.
What are you tracking with? Because you were tracking here when last time I taught you.
No, I don't track here.
Oh, you don't track at all?
I just don't track here. This is just for mixing.
What's your sort of favorite tracking rooms?
In Nashville?
Yeah.
We work in Oceanway and Blackbird a lot and nice. Sound Emporium, which is an awesome old room.
That's when we were going to do the second Frey record. We weren't sure where we were going to do it, but it was between Sound Emporium and where we ended up doing it.
Which was here?
No, we didn't do it here in the end. But we came back to Blackbird and cut a whole bunch of EPs and other
cool.
stuff there.
Yeah.
So, and we, of course, in Studio D, which seems to be everybody's favorite.
That's the one. Yeah. So, Studio D, Oceanway, Sound Emporium, and then Dave Cobb's place, Grand Victor, RCA Studio A, you know, which is, he's got it kind of locked out now. But
Did he buy the building?
No, I think he just leased it for a couple of years.
Nice. Yeah, I forgot to text him. But yeah, I'd love to go and check it out.
He'll be there tonight.
Yeah. All right, I'll give him shit tonight.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
We're going to, where's the party? Is it
Vance's, Sputnik.
Sputnik.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be fun.
Yes.
That'll be fun. We'll see. Jonathan Pines wants me to film there. I just don't know.
It's going to be wall-to-wall people.
That's what Matt said. Ross Spang. He said, don't even bother.
Don't even bother.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, it'll be fun. We'll get some cell phone footage and photos
and
stuff like that.
Yeah, that would totally work.
So, beautiful console.
Thanks.
Are you using this a lot still? Because I love mine.
I do too.
I've tried all the different ones, and I don't want to trash talk everybody's 4,000 bus compressor simulations, emulations, rebuilds, or whatever. But I've never found one that sounds as good as the one that's in my console.
No, me neither.
Yeah, and I had one engineer once tell me the reason why, and I don't remember what it was. But it's something about, I think from, what year is yours?
84.
I think mine's 85. Maybe it's plasma, so I think it's 85. And he just told me that the DBX VCAs, there's that ones, is that what they call it?
That's the newer ones.
Yeah, he just said there's something that there's some difference in them. That
I don't know, it sounds great.
Yeah, I don't know either.
And I really like this particular one, like when I got the console, I just noticed like, oh, this one sounds really cool.
Yeah.
So yeah, I use it all the time.
There must be something in that vintage, I don't know. Because I know when I've asked people that know and I don't know, it's very important that people know that I'm not an expert, I'm just have my personal opinion. I think that I feel like they've made so many, but there seems to be something about that mid-80s thing. I don't know. I wish I knew.
I don't either.
It could be old voodoo or mumbo jumbo for all I know, but they sound great. So it's nice to see a lot of engaged EQ, and you're aggressive, and I see you got the channel out. You like to go into it, which is kind of the SSL sound, isn't it?
Yeah,
the EQ into compression gives you that kind of spankiness.
I just like EQing into compression anyway.
Oh, you do?
I mean, it keeps you from like shit going crazy at a certain frequency.
Yeah.
Like you kind of step on it.
And there's the magic with the fact that it's the automatic gain control, I suppose.
Whatever that thing is.
Whatever you want to call it. Yeah. Please leave the proper terminology below. The magic in that is just unbelievable.
Yeah, it really is. And it works on stuff that you wouldn't think it works on, like vocals. And, you know, it's like I turn it off and I'm like, I can do vocals better. It's like, man, just a little tiny bit of that is so cool.
Yeah, I have no idea what is going on in this dynamic section. But as soon as I put that compression in, it brings it, it's the same volume, but it just brings it forward.
Yep.
And yeah, there's some magic in it. And not to be underestimated. Now, the great thing is that you have this company that you have Atomic with, what's your business partner called again?
Norman.
And you're bringing fresh life back to these consoles.
Yeah, or at least trying to preserve them.
Right.
You know, because there's those of us who have a lot of money in them, and there's those of us who just really love the way they sound, so we wanted to kind of help them keep going for a very long time.
Which I think is pretty special.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I really don't want to, you know, I've been going through this, and I did a video recently mixing completely in the box, and I got a good result, but I also was comparing against an SSL mix. So it's a little bit like, you know, I bet you've had these situations where you've spent ages, you've mixed something incredible. Then the label has said, oh no, this guy's going to remix the single. And you've been that guy also that's received another Class A mix. And look, let's be honest. I mean, if we can be blessed to have an amazing mix to compare against all the time, it's a great position
that'd be
to
great.
Be. It'd be great, yeah. Most of the time it's a rough and it is what it is. But every now and then you get a Class A mix and you're like, you listen to it and go, well, if he just turned the click up on the kick drum in the choruses, it would be amazing. And then you go in there and fix those little tiny mistakes. So I was blessed to be able to mix in the box, comparing against a hybrid mix through a console. So that was easy. But there's something about having the SSL that just makes, it does a lot of my work for me. And you obviously know that yourself.
Well, yeah, I just did a mix. I did a mix a day ago. Yep. And it was one of those things where it just needed aggression and life and it went so fast on the desk,
right?
Because you can just overcrank something and like really slam this and that and do some crazy stuff. And it's so difficult to do that in the box. Yeah. Like things get loud, but they don't get rowdy.
Yeah.
You know, like reverbs sound like reverbs, but they don't blend into the, I don't know. It's really strange. Yeah. And I mean, there's guys who are doing amazing in the box mixes.
Yeah. Adam Shapps, Neil Avron, they mix in the box.
Servin. They do killer stuff, and that's great. And I just did a Disney project. It has to be mixed in the box because we're turning it in like 40 stereo stems, and they all have to be a certain this and a certain that. It's like, it's got to be in the box. So that's fine too, but we're at a point where we can do what we prefer, and I prefer this.
So. Yeah. Yeah, that's great. And the power supply is helping us out.
The power supply is helping us out. You know, the long story short on the Atomic was when I finally put this studio together, it was completely nerve-wracking because now all of a sudden all the maintenance was on me, and you know I had been in studios for years and years and years, and it's like, oh my gosh, what are we gonna do? We have a lot of thunderstorms here and a lot of power abnormalities, and I just got sick of repairing my power supplies, and I couldn't afford to deal with having a console down if someone was coming in or if you were working. So
my console Norman was and down I started up working until yesterday morning. So
really?
Trust me.
Yeah. Yes. Well, so Norman and I started, Norman said he's like, I can fix this problem, and we refined it, and basically we were just designing it as a way to keep this thing happy and run on less, money.
Yep.
And as it turns out, it sounds better and it's a much lower noise floor, which was kind of cool.
Oh yeah. Look, everybody I know that uses them says the noise floor is pretty crazy.
Yeah. So that's the big admission is we didn't design it for it to sound better. We were designing it just to extend the life of the console. It just happens to sound better. And honestly, if you have an SSL supply that Bruce Millett's gone through and it's perfect, I'm sure that they're very similar.
We all know and love Bruce. He's the guy.
I mean, just anything that's like top, it's top notch. The Atomic gives you ridiculous amounts of power on the rails. And it's always exactly where it's supposed to be. It doesn't move. It doesn't drift. It doesn't, Tom's got one. Elmhurst has one on his VR. Clear Mountain has one.
Clear Mountain has one on the SSL, though.
On his SSL, yep.
Yeah, that's a big deal.
Yep. That was, people ask us about demoing them, and people ask us about sound and all that. And we were just like, if Bob Clear Mountain says it sounds good, done.
Yeah, I have this theory, and it's only my theory, and nobody has to agree. I have this theory. Bob and Joe Ciccarelli are my two guys that I use this theory in. And every mastering engineer that ever lived. When you go, I'll use mastering engineers for a second. You go to a mastering engineer, all of them, Pete, Maor, Adam, Bob Ludwig, Ted Jensen, they all have their gear that they love. And they all swear that they know best. And, and sometimes it actually goes against logic and electronics facts and all this kind of stuff. But the point is that that's what they need to get a great product. Mm-hmm. They have to be passionate about this particular tube amp that actually isn't doing what they think it's doing or whatever. Some electronics engineer will go, no, that's not right. It doesn't matter. Because if those eight pieces of high quality equipment, like, get the result that comes out that sounds absolutely unbelievable. Because you and I know that a great mastering engineer is worth his weight in gold.
Yeah.
It's rare for me to send something to a mastering engineer that doesn't come back, at least once every 10 times worse. Most of the time, But the guys that I've chosen to use, like Adam, it always comes back better. Mm-hmm. It's like hallelujah.
You thank know? You, Adam.
Yeah, the great guys, the really true great guys. And so for me, if Bob says something is better, or Joe Ciccarelli, did you see the Joe thing where he's talking about he doesn't like bouncing to disc?
He needs to get over that.
Yeah, okay.
Joe, you need to get over that. It's different now.
And I agree.
But he was right before.
You understand where I'm going.
Yeah.
If that's what he needs to do.
More power to him.
More power to him. And I think that that's important. When people get like the trolling, aggressive about that stuff, it's like, as far as I'm concerned, I engineer my records, I produce my records, I mix my records. But you want to put a gun to my head? Freaking Joe Ciccarelli is probably the greatest living engineer. Yeah, his records sound amazing.
Yes, when I get to mix tracks that Joe has cut, it's just like a party. It's like vacation. They're so good.
He's so anal. Every musician I've ever worked with him is like, sometimes they're so frustrated about how anal he is about getting the right sound.
Yeah, but he's right. So he's, you might as well roll with it. Yeah.
So for me, it's like, he's probably wrong, and I don't mind this being on camera, he's probably wrong about the new bounce to disc. If he is wrong about the new bounce to disc, they've refined it, they've figured it out, and as Frank Filippetti said, flip the phase, there's no artifacts, there's nothing left, so they're exactly the same.
Yeah,
I agree, but is that part of Joe Ciccarelli's process to get the best sounding tracks ever? Then he's right.
Yeah, I don't care. I don't care what he does. He can stand on his head for all I care.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's a weird one. I think that's what I think, you know, we're having this Pete Lyman, you know, he's mastering most of the vinyl in probably in the world at the moment. I mean, he's the guy people come to. But again, on camera, he's like, oh no, vinyl doesn't sound better. But it's the experience.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, we were just having this conversation. Ted was just down here 2 days ago. And we were talking about Doug Sax's mastering setup.
Yeah.
And apparently, I don't know for sure, he knows a lot more about it than I do, but and this other guy, Jonathan Pines, was talking about it too. And
yeah,
like, all of the pieces in Doug's setup aren't great. They weren't like the best. This thing wasn't the best. But when you put them all together and you use them the way Ted said, to get Doug's magic, you have to use everything that Doug was using. Like the whole signal chain together was magic. One piece here or there, meh, that's not a great amplifier. That's not a great whatever. But together, it's perfect.
Yeah. Exactly.
So
it's all.
So what you make of it?
Yeah, it's all what you make of it. And I think that's important. I think that's a really important philosophy, because there is no right way or wrong way of doing anything.
No.
And again, I mean, all my favorite records aren't necessarily the best recorded. They've got the best performances, and they've got some of the best sounds, some of the most interesting things. But it doesn't mean that they all sound like they were recorded by Blumlein mic, you know, in a perfectly acoustically treated room. I don't actually know if I want to listen to anything that's recorded like
that. I've never had luck using that technique on anything, by the way.
So, you know what I mean? Like the most hi-fi sounding perfect recording of an instrument.
What's your favorite recording?
My favorite recording ever? Queen, Night of the Opera.
Yeah. Kind of Blue.
Kind of Blue.
Which was like 4 or 5 microphones in a really great room.
Yeah. Yeah. But I agree with you. If you put my top 5 records, Kind of Blue would be in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Freddie Freeloader. And, Kind of Blue, Night of the Opera. Here's one that, there's two that mix in and around that. Raw Power by the Stooges, which is probably one of the worst, best recordings ever. I mean, when Search and Destroy, the guitar solo comes in, it's probably, not exaggerating, 6 dB too loud. And everything just disappears. It just kind of ducks the rest of the band. And the guitar solo comes in, but it rips your ears off. And it's punk rock is the way punk rock was supposed to be.
Yeah.
Even though they didn't know they were doing punk rock. I got to speak to James when they got back together. And he's like, no, we're not a punk rock band. It's just like, we were trying to be rock. We just weren't that good.
Right. Totally. Yeah, I love stuff like that. You listen to old Rolling Stones and you'll hear the tambourine come in like super loud, and then somebody will pull, you know, go measure in half and they'll pull it down, and it's because the flying fingers.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, like Dark Side of the Moon, they wouldn't have automation. So they had all the band, the assistants, you know, everybody was sitting there like, you know, like, oh, you missed the cue. Just do it again. You know?
Right.
No SMPTE, so you had to do it in real time. There was no way to line it back
up. But now we have automation. So now the trick is not using it until everything is so homogenized that it's boring.
Yeah. That was Shelly Akers' thing. It's funny, when I was talking to Shelly about that, and, you know, he's made some of the best-selling records ever. And I was like, what do you think about using automation? And he was the same way. He's like, you just got to kind of stop pretty quickly. Like, what's the thing that really you have to fix? But then if you get into the mentality of fixing everything, yeah. For me, I think, I want to know what your theory on this. My theory is like, when I've had the break and I've taken the time away, whether it's the next day, whether it's an hour later, whatever, my only reaction that's important is my first one.
Yeah, that's also why I like, why I really like artists coming in to the studio, because they're hearing it for the first time and they're not hearing it in a space that's comfortable. They're hearing a space that's new. So like they'll hear stuff. And I always find out, like if we're working together and you come to the studio and you sit down and you listen, I'll hear something that I wasn't hearing that I was like, oh my gosh, why didn't I do that?
That
every single
to
time.
Me, so, yeah.
It's just a psychological shift, I think, which is healthy.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
You know?
Yeah. I think, look, we're blessed. We're blessed to be able to do this, Schnizzle. And no bulls. I was looking at it going, no cattle, no all.
No bullshit.
All right, let's look at some of this beautiful gear. All right, just because it's the first thing I just saw when I stood up, and it's got the famous words Fairchild written on it.
Fairchild.
Famous words, sorry. What is that?
That is a 602. That was a de-esser that they used for lathes, a stereo de-esser.
Oh.
So it's basically just a way to run something through iron. So this is on an insert on my Dangerous Liaison, and I can just pop it in and off the mix bus.
Nice.
I just did something that was kind of throwback, like kind of old school, and we just cranked the de-esser up a little bit and put it on the mix bus, and it instantly just kind of made that old school, slightly mellow. Like, it's really cool.
You know, these are suddenly going to, these are going to be left like 50 grand off this conversation.
Oh, I don't think so. You know, I mean, it's, this isn't a popular, I mean, there's a few of these around, and it's just color. It's just a color box. Actually, this is all color. None of this is, you can get a great EQ in the box. You can get a great, if you want a limiter that just stops stuff, it's in the box. This is all color.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah, limiters and...
Like that. That.
An actual de-essing is better off in the box.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Because you can just sit there
and pick those out. Well, I kind of still like these.
Oh, you do like
the 902s? Yeah.
902s?
I use those and stuff in the box, but...
So what is this that you just pointed to?
That's an old Ampex tube mixer, and there is a parallel on my mix bus going out and going through that. Do you remember? We talked about that when we worked, and it was like, something's a little bit crunchy, click, turn it off, that was that.
I remember.
It's a little bit of weird transformer distortion, I mean, a very tiny bit.
So that's nice. So just to move over here, because we're talking about it, so you're using this to insert parallel?
Yeah, the dangerous, this thing is awesome because you can put 6 different inserts, change the way you do it, do a parallel, do a blend, and save presets, and just pop them in and out and audition them like that, like the stuff on your mix bus. Like, it is awesome.
How do you save the presets?
Have 4 presets right here.
I see.
You can hold and they'll hit store and all that stuff.
Just like your hi-fi.
Some people use it for tracking too. You can audition like a bunch of different mic pre's and a bunch of different compressors and all that stuff, or you can put them in a chain. But I'm it's indispensable for mixing. So,
how you got yours black and white? Mine's green.
I just ran it into the black and white channel of that TV.
That'd be so much easier on the eyes.
Yeah,
you're a smarter man than me. All right, I'm gonna do that.
There's a cheap little Chinese box I got off eBay that converts it, and you can tell it to just go black and white. It's like $30.
All right, I'm going to get that from you. Right. I'm learning a lot about my SSL.
It's under the
you.
Floor. It's going to take a minute to get that, but
this. So what are these? Are these kind of your? These are some Rogers.
Yeah, these are Rogers LS35A.
Yeah, this is
brilliant speakers. I love these speakers. All my clients love these speakers. They're fantastic.
Well, the LS3s, for those people who don't know, are BBC design.
Yep.
Yeah.
These were spec'd in all the BBC studios. They had 2 speakers, the big ones and the small ones, in every BBC studio in the whole country.
This is
really great speakers.
Yeah.
Macintosh amp driving them. They're fantastic. I do at least half of my mixing on these.
Nice.
Off to the side.
Very nice indeed.
Yep.
And so you got this from Jonathan just the other day, presumably?
I did, yeah. I haven't got a chance to play with it yet, but I'm really looking forward to it.
You know what? It's do you like your SSL headphone best? Do you monitor from your SSL headphone output?
No.
You don't?
I don't use the monitoring section at all.
Oh, you don't?
Hmm.
Oh, so you're just going channels. And then you're coming back using the dangerous?
Yeah. Yeah, the dangerous monitoring is so much better than the SSL monitoring. I just finally skipped it, and I never want to go back.
Oh,
I've never been a fan of the 4000 monitoring section.
Right.
You have a headphone out?
Yeah, there's a whole headphone channel section, which is like this huge 19-inch rack mount.
That I've seen those.
And
is it cool?
Yeah, I mean, most mixers back in ye olden days of the 80s, that's how they, you know, if they were headphone checking, they were mixing headphones and they were always using that. Hmm. And I basically A-B'd it. They're pretty comparable. And yeah. I can mix off my SSL headphones and
they sound
fantastic.
Sweet.
There's a lot of depth in it. You basically, when you're on the SSL one, you feel like you have depth, and then when you put it into your laptop, you feel like the depth just disappeared. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, you've just got the usual, you know, no disrespect to Apple, but you've got like whatever their generic.
They're not designed to drive headphones.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we've got the Rupert Neve one, and I've also got the Little Labs one, and we're going to have a big shootout when we have time to play around.
Yeah, let me know how it goes with the Little Labs against it. I haven't had a chance to listen to Little Labs stuff, the headphone.
He's a genius. Jonathan is, all of his designs are super cool.
I got the voice of God. I don't have a use for it. I actually ended up using it on a bass, and when we came to master, they were like, this is weird bump. I think it's one of those things that is, I've still got it, and I think I can find, it's more of a special effects thing
it
for
is.
Me.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I use it occasionally on vocals. I like it for tracking.
Yeah.
Like low tom.
That
makes
sense.
Sometimes a kick drum or a sub kick, something you can tune. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that makes sense to me, yeah. But yeah, no, his stuff's great, and I love his, what's the guitar?
The PCP or the splitter with the controls, and yeah, that's one of the pieces of my gear that disappeared into Nashville, and I can't find it.
So that's great but if you're tracking mainly in other rooms and stuff like that, for me, it's like, it's just, you know, have that and have tons of amps running and be able to, No, he's a very, very smart man, and he makes stuff that you really need.
Yes, and he names it really funny things, which is key.
But I think you'll like this, you know, depending on how you're used to monitoring. I think this is a good idea for guys that, you know, want to monitor from their headphones. They want to beat their little I.O. headphones, and they're going to notice a difference between that and their laptops and the other ways that they're being forced to monitor.
The thing that really blew me away with these guys is their DI is amazing.
DI is really good. Yeah.
There's like an extra octave on the bottom. It's incredible.
Yeah. So. But you'll like it because it has good depth. But I'll be intrigued to see what you think compared with the Little Labs, because I know that's going to be great too. Okay, so some nice stuff here. The Aphex.
Aphex is a cheat for toms that I use occasionally.
Ah, nice. So you can get in there and add some subs and stuff like that and tune down low. Distressors, they're pretty much the most used compressor these days, aren't they?
I mean, they're just, Dave's stuff is, those are great. I wish they were digitally controlled from the computer, Dave. Because then I'd have 20 of them.
You think that would be...
I've been asking him to do that for like 10 years.
All right, well, I'm going to put a word in as well. Because I haven't used the arouser yet, but I just saw, have you tried it?
It's not, is it out?
Yeah, it's out. Yeah.
It is? I haven't tried it yet.
All right, so Poltex.
Kick and
snare. The manly ones.
Yep.
What are you using them on?
Kick and snare.
Kick and snare? Mm-hmm. Great. Very nice indeed.
Drummer, snare, just to clean it up.
I love drummer.
Yep.
So you are mixing using this gate?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Do you use the SSL gates at all?
Mm-hmm.
I like the expander on those.
This one is the one that kind of the snare goes through this, and it goes through the Neve getting like obliterated, and that's kind of cleaning it up so it's not tons and tons of bleed. It's just the transient.
Nice. So. Very nice indeed. Ah, it's nice to see one of these.
Inovonics, yeah. Really great on bass. I use it on snare drum. That's my secret for bringing like the ghost stuff out. You know, the in-between notes. Like, it's really good for that for whatever reason. I don't know why.
No, that's fantastic. I don't see many of these around. They have a pair of these in Studio
storage.
2 in storage in Sunset.
Really great on bass if you get a chance. There's a mod that you have to do with them to make them not be all weird broadcasty.
Right.
Like, there's something in there you got to fix, but they're really great on bass too.
Nice. And then what are you using the 33609 on?
That one side of it is the snare like crush, like right. that. Pow. The other side is sometimes bass, sometimes vocals, whatever.
Right. I like this. I love everything Neve, you know, like all of us, you know, pre's. Between this and what's the classic one? The 3369 and the...
This?
Those.
2254.
The 2254s. I could never use them on a mix bus.
No. Depends on the project.
Yeah, I think if I wanted totally spongy 70s, yep. I'd probably put that
those.
Across.
Yep.
Yeah. But in just general modern being pretty much anything over the last 20 years, yeah, the SSL is the only real one that ever kind of works for me.
No, that's, me too.
And then 1178, is that?
Yeah. Overheads.
Oh, nice.
Does very great nice. Things on overheads.
Yeah, there was a time when we were kids, people hated 1178, so I don't know why. I think they're freaking awesome.
Yeah, me too.
I could have 10 of those things. What's this?
That's just a stereo
Calrec. Oh, it's a Calrec.
Yep.
Oh, wow.
It's a really interesting compressor. It's kind of SSL-ish, and then it's kind of Neve-ish, and I use that sometimes on drums. I use that for tracking. It was actually, I think I was using it for makeup gain on these until we had it modded.
So, yes, now we get to see the light comes in and hits them like this, and they flash
the pies.
Off like this.
Yeah.
The pies. The holy grail of compressors. Mm-hmm. When did you get these?
I've had them for a long time.
You have?
Yeah.
Ever since mine went missing?
Yeah.
The day after?
Yeah, wouldn't that be awesome?
Barisi has a pair as well, and and they look suspiciously more like mine than yours does. Yours look cleaner than mine did. Mine are a bit more beaten up.
Best drum room compressor ever.
Yeah. Which is, yeah.
They just sound amazing on drums. I have tried everything. They kind of got wonky, so I had to send them back to Vintage King to get fixed.
Yeah.
And I tried everything. And then you put these back on, you're just like, all right, fine. Some things just work better.
It's just like, yeah, this is the holy grail of compressors. Between this and like a 670, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, yeah, this
and
magic.
These guys.
You know, 1176s.
Yeah.
God bless them.
I love those.
Yeah. So 1176s, you've got these different varieties. I'm not an expert. That's the Rev D.
Yep, that's a D. Some are Fs, some are Ds, then the blue stripes, obviously.
So tell us about this.
That's just an old passive EQ, and I'm running it through this DBX as makeup, and that's one of my bass chains.
Oh.
So that's like a real like low-end, thick thing, and then I blend in an 1176, an SSL EQ, and that's kind of like the bitey, like a tacky, and then you just kind of blend those two.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
The 165s love these things.
Yeah,
I have a pair of these. But you're right. This and this, as a combination, those are my two favorite together.
Mm.
Soft compression, hard limiting.
One into the other.
Yeah, one into the other.
On vocals, bass, yeah.
Vocals and bass, exactly. Anything you do on a vocal, you can do on a bass.
So you do this and then that?
No,
or the other way around? That
soft
and then
hard, yeah. So I do this. I do this into this. So this is on 20:1. And this is usually about 3 or 4.
Yeah.
Because this, and this is just like bah!
Yep.
Catches. Mm-hmm. With Stephen's vocal, it was this and this. Actually, with Stephen and with Isaac from the Fray, I went 1073 and then I split and I did parallel compression and printed parallel vocals.
Interesting.
Yeah, and it just comes out like this.
I love the Fray vocals. They're fantastic.
Thank you. Yeah, so. Those first two albums, the second album in particular was done like that, and the vocals just there the whole time.
I'm stealing that. You know, Churchyard used to use the 160X,
yeah,
I
that's
think,
good.
Which is the abbreviated version of that. Yeah. So that's Transformers, right?
Yeah.
For vocals, exactly the same thing.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's something about DBX stuff which is really wonderful. The 120 I use for the sub on my kick. Is that what you're using as well?
Disco Boom.
Oh, you've got the real one. You see, you've got the one. That, between you and you and Dave Sardi, the only guys, Dave has one as well. Sardi has, I think he has two actually. He'll never sell one. Yeah, that's the predecessor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Plus it says Disco Boom on it. Like it actually says disco and it has,
And that was for those people that don't know, that was for DJs. They would put that in their PAs. And when they were, mixing, they weren't even mixing in those days, just playing back 70s records. It had that boom going on. All right, so next up. You got some more 900 series stuff.
Yep, some 900s.
And what are those ones?
Those were actually on backgrounds. I don't know that I'm even using those right now.
And then some Chandler.
Okay, so this thing is another little secret that I discovered. This is what I call my string bus.
Yeah.
But strings, whirlies, sometimes pads, analog synths, like through this thing.
That's fantastic.
Sound awesome. I don't know what it does. It just does a really great thing.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's... all I hear is good stuff. I actually haven't owned any Chandler stuff. Dave Sardi uses the TGs when we were mixing. Yeah. He would put those on the bus.
Yeah, the TGs sound great. These are awesome. The germanium preamp that he has in the 500 series sounds really great. The TG1 is awesome for tracking drums. I love that thing.
Yeah, great things. Then surge protector?
Yep, surge protector with shunt trip protection. The whole room's on that. If voltage goes out over or under, it'll just turn off the gear and it won't turn back on until I power it.
Oh, nice.
So then that's just super hardcore surge protection.
More distressors.
More distressors. Drum parallel.
Oh, nice.
I'm gonna.
Drum parallel. Some Pultex.
Yep. Some Pultex. Mix busted the SSLs. Got some Pultex. Got Focusrite red. Got a little Avalon action.
Oh, so you're using the red as well.
Uh-huh.
That's very crisp of you.
Sounds good.
He does the red and the mix bus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Although he uses a lot of reduction on that. He probably wouldn't admit this. Yeah, a lot more than
I thought.
If it sounds good, it sounds good.
His stuff is amazing. The old Neves, those things are like the coolest compressors ever.
What are you using them on?
I use them on bass. I use them on drums sometimes. I'll use them on a mix bus, if, like you said, if you want it to kind of be old school and spongy.
Yep.
Everything that goes through them sounds good.
The Avalon, what's that going to use?
Mix bus.
Oh, mix bus as well?
Yep. There's a weird little circuit in that thing. What is it even called? TSP.
Yeah.
Tube signal path. I'm not a fan of the compressor. I'm using a tiny bit of the EQ, but the tube signal path thing with old Mullard tubes in it just sounds really cool.
Oh, it does?
Mm-hmm.
See, I had a pair of 737s.
Yep.
And didn't use the compressor at all, but the EQ is really good on guitars.
Mm-hmm.
Because it just does that. It's like Manly. There's something about a Verimu that I don't really do much with it, and I don't have one. But when I go to a studio and they have a Verimu and they have a pair of them, amazing on a guitar bus, because they just tidy up the top end without really doing anything. It's like they just kind of pull the top end in a little bit. Nice.
Yeah, a little Echoplex.
Yeah, I have one too.
Sonic Mayhem.
Yeah, I use mine on a lead vocal and then pull it back in time. I print it and then pull it back in under time because it just distorts, so it adds some character under the vocal. Yeah.
Important safety tip. There is a plug on here labeled foot switch, echo, on and off. But if you plug into that as an output, it's actually just like a really cool clipping distortion.
Oh, nice.
I have no idea why.
Oh, wow.
We plugged into it by accident and came up with this amazingly cool vocal sound. We're like, oh, all right, let's try that.
All right, I'm going to try that. Thank you. So this is what's driving your BBC speakers?
Yep.
Nice. How'd you find this? These are rare as rocking horse.
I don't know. Poop. That's been around for a long time. I don't remember where I found that.
Yeah, you did well by finding that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I very rarely see this. I have a Marantz that people love, so that's good.
I love those too.
But not as good as that. Okay, some more dangerous stuff.
Yeah, some more weird stuff. Dangerous Spax EQ, a little bit on the mix bus occasionally. This is a guy out of England who modified this thing. It's a little stereo spread deal that I can pop in and out of the mix bus if I want it.
That's really cool.
Yeah, the Omnipressor we talked about, that thing's just awesome.
Yeah, that's just like, it's another one of those, a handful of people know about them, but yeah, the expand compress. I mean, they don't sound like any expand or compressor I've ever used. They're just, I don't know what's going on.
I don't know what goes.
My naive assumption feels like somehow or another that something's doubled back on itself by mistake and feeding in, and I don't know.
It's possible they're all broken.
Yeah, exactly. Like they made a mistake when they manufactured them, which sounds amazing.
Right, it sounds incredible.
Who knows? So, yeah, if you get a good chance to buy one of these cheap, just buy it.
Yeah, just grab it. So much fun.
More Pultex?
Well, this is where, so here's where we go into vocal land. And what it is this is usually an LA-2A that's out on loan. And this is usually a retro 176 that I also just loaned to a buddy because I'm about to go out of town and, whatever.
Yeah.
So my vocals go through this EQ and the retro EQ, and they go through the Millennia Origin for EQ and the vacuum tube or solid state gain stage.
Yep.
So you can just pop it in and out, and usually one's great and one isn't.
Great.
And then these are all vocal compressors going through 902s and coming up on the console, and then I just blend like four or five different vocal compressors to get whatever character I want.
Oh, nice.
So those blend, and then they go through the EQ bus and the SSL.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy.
That's quite Michael Brower of you. He have you seen what he does?
I haven't been in his room since he moved to Lady. But yeah,
no,
I
mean, I've been to move to Lady.
Yeah,
but you remember, you'd look around and you'd be like, what
"Oh yeah,
is
he's
going
got
on?
Yeah, he's got problems."
Yeah, it's like, what is going
but
on?
But it sounds amazing. So, Mike, whatever you're doing, like,
yeah, totally. It was just like, there's like a, he has, doesn't he have like, he has all his distresses going on the drums, just like. What mode's he in? Is he in nuke? And it's, but no, is he in? It's basically just goes. What
it
happens?
Just flashes, right?
It just goes flashes all the lights when a snare hits, then goes off immediately. Yep. So it just kind of goes. Pop, 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 pop. The snare
that's
fills
that
in.
British mode thing.
That's the British mode he's using Yeah, and he's just got like, and but then with vocals, he has like tape delays, and he has like two or three of those going, and a different verb and a different delay and a different this and a different plate and a whatever, and 18 different compressors, and you're watching all this stuff going like this, just flashing on and off.
Yeah, and whatever makes the sound that he got on that Athlete record, I am a fan of.
Yeah.
Like, that was just super killer. So, yeah. I mean, I do weird stuff too. This is an insert.
Oh, I know you do.
This is a triad transformer
that
I've just actually got on a Pro Tools insert, and I'll throw that on a vocal. I was just using it on a vocal.
Oh, wow.
And it's weird. In fact, I did a Motown, a song called Motown, but it was a throwback thing. And so I put that in, gained into it, clipped it, and gained back down.
It's made in Huntington, Indiana.
Yeah, there you go.
There you go. Connor was made in Indiana. So the gold, the Lavery gold, are you mixing to that?
Yep. That's my A to D.
Oh, nice. I mixed to a Lavery blue.
All of Dan's stuff is phenomenal.
Yeah, it's wonderful. It's interesting because I've met with Barry over at Radar, who is one of the most anal guys with stuff, and he won't mind me saying this, but with Barry, he doesn't have a lot of love for most A to D. He doesn't, with converters, he's very opinionated. He's very opinionated. So if you mention any of the usual suspects, he's like, no, 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 no. And I'm like, but I mixed to a Lavery. He goes, oh, these guys are amazing.
Yeah. Dan's a genius.
So when the guy from Radar who hates, big word, who is critical of other people's converters says that the Lavery's good, you know it's good.
Yeah.
So some blue stripes there.
Yep.
For the grit, what are you using those on?
Vocals.
On vocals?
All these are vocals.
Oh, all vocals, sorry. Nice. And then what is that underneath?
That's an Electrodyne.
Oh, it's an Electrodyne. I should see the little E logo over there. Very nice. And then all the 900 series?
Just for, again, coming out of these. I have found with certain old compressors, running them through a DBX 902 makes them sound better, even if it's not on. Like an LA-28 into a 902 sounds better. I don't know why. It loads it weird. I don't know. But I use it for that and a little bit of de-essing.
So a bit of magic.
Yep.
Now we've got all of, we haven't talked about this. What's this, the dangerous compressor?
That's the dangerous mastering compressor. Again, it's one of those things that it's tough. You know, we were talking about doing videos about it, but what it's best at is a tiny bit of compression. You know, it's just that glue kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to make a video, being on YouTube, something that's like a half a dB of.
Yeah.
But it's a fantastic glue. Like, I put it on and then I took it off because I was going to send it back, and then I started missing it. So it just stays here now.
No, I know what you mean. I have these conversations all the time. Where I tell people honestly, if I was starting again, I don't know how I'd do it because I've got six Poltex. Who has six Poltex? Who would go out of their way to buy and spend that much money on equipment? But it's like 20 years of accumulating equipment. And it's tough because a lot of the time we find something that works, and it works on one thing. And it, like you said, it just does this.
Yep.
And you boot, maybe it's a boost of an EQ on one thing. You've got five bands and you're only boosting one band. I mean, who in their right mind, starting today, would do that?
Nobody. Nobody in their right mind would do that anyway. We all have to be crazy to get that far into it. But that's okay.
Yeah, that's okay.
Got to be crazy about something. Might as well do it about this.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there's a lot worse things you can be crazy
totally.
About.
Totally.
Now, with the with this, you're using this for inserts on...
Summing. Summing. Yep.
Right.
Because sometimes I don't want to go through the SSL. I just want to skip it. So the SSL goes into that, and some stuff that skips the SSL goes into that. And if I don't want it to go through this and have that character, I just skip it and go to the dangerous.
Oh, nice. So. Nice. Look at you.
Yeah, Dolby.
So you're doing the vocal trick?
Sometimes. When it needs it. Yep.
Yeah. That's I think we doubled the price of those when we interviewed Christopher Thorne.
A bit.
Yeah. And people were commenting. They were like, I was looking at this yesterday and it was $175. Now it's $450.
Yep. That happens. Yeah. That happens a lot.
Yeah. And no, they're, yeah. The guy that I think of for this, lots of people I know do it, but the one was David Kahn with Regina Spektor.
Mm-hmm.
He went, the couple of albums he did with her, her voice just has this, this air. And I would track and I would get my sing. I'd be like, can you breathe through? And, you know, because, you know, the technique of singing.
Yeah, and letting
and breathing
it out.
Through. Mm-hmm. But that you can't get it on every note. And I was like, and then I remember his name. Sorry, I'm blanking on the engineer who worked on that record. I can see his face. Anyway, the engineer that worked on one of those records was like, oh, no, he's not doing anything special. He's doing something special, but it's not in the production. It's in the mix. Yeah. And so it's the Dolby A.
Yep.
And then, you know, Mark Needham has one. Mm-hmm. He uses it on his vocals. And then I started to find, oh, this is the secret weapon that's not so secret anymore. Cliff Mag, great guy.
Yes.
Great
lovely
stuff.
Lovely people. Great stuff. This is all, this and the Cappy mm-hmm. stuff is on the mix bus. A tiny bit of Mag EQ, and this is a line stage I'm just using for color on the mix bus.
Oh, really?
Yep. It runs at, is it running at Unity? Yep, it's running at Unity. That's just it. It's Transformers. It's a really interesting color.
Interesting.
I've been using it for a long time.
Yeah, this, you, Rob Snaff's a big fan as well. Mm-hmm. Quite a few guys I know I just love this guy's stuff. Yeah. And from what I can tell, it's very affordable as well, isn't it?
It is, yeah, it's fantastic. And easy to build if you're into the DIY thing. Like I was just talking to somebody and they're like, some kits are tough, these are really well done, so they're easy.
Yeah, but even for me, it's probably beyond
no,
me.
I got kids, so.
So more of his stuff here, more of Cliff's?
Yeah,
more of
those are filters. I mean, I use the Cliff EQs on a lot of stuff. I use them more for tracking other than my mix bus stuff. Those are filters, just filtering out like the boombox and some stuff that needs some low-end filter stuff. And then these are just inserts.
We got a Voice of God.
Yeah, Voice of God, the standard leveler for destroying drum rooms.
Nice.
You know, I'll patch it in and then print it.
And then how are you using the little radios here?
Same thing, like I've got another one over there that I'll insert guitar pedals and, you know, use those on vocals or whatever.
And then blend it back in.
Yep.
Nice. And the 3-3-6-0-9?
Yep. That one's usually for tracking. He's just sitting there for fun.
The 3A is actually my favorite electric guitar compressor.
That's all they're used on, electric guitar.
Yeah, they're amazing.
In fact, sometimes I'll cut electric guitar and I don't generally compress when I cut it. Right. But I'll turn the compression off and just run it through the gain stage because it gives that aggressive.
I don't know what it is. They're magic.
Yeah, they're great.
And if you want, you know, Fleetwood Mac, just get that.
Yep. Perfect.
Yeah. I didn't. When I first moved to America 20 years ago, you could pick these up for like $200. Nobody liked them at all. And now, of course, yeah, everybody knows about them.
Did you see how expensive they are?
Yeah, I know.
They're insane.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, it sucks.
It's ridiculous.
Okay, so Burrow converters, they sound unbelievable. I use those and I use the Euphonics, which were apparently like a Meitner on one end and Lavery on the other as far as like circuit design.
Oh.
So great converters.
Nice.
And what else? The boombox is down there. The AN2 is just a stereo thing. It's a really good stereo simulator. I don't know why it sounds good, but it does. I still haven't found anything in the box that makes the stereo thing right. So I guess it's just a chorus, really.
Fantastic. And then, of course, our disco boombox.
Yep.
Now, speakers.
Speakers are...
ATCs.
The ATCs, the Pro-X. There's usually a pair of Unity Audios in right there. Buddy blew his speakers and needed a loan, so they're out on loan.
The Rocks or the Super Rocks?
The Rocks.
The Rocks. Yep. They just loan me the Super Rocks, which...
I dig them.
Have you tried the Super Rocks yet?
No, I haven't tried the Super Rocks. I like these for low-level, like, critical listening, almost what you would do with Grotto headphones, like, you know, looking for distortion problems and like just really nice low level stuff.
I'm pretty impressed. This is going to sound like a horrible name drop, but it's the truth. So when they brought them by, I was working with Jack Douglas. So I'm working with Jack and I was like, we pulled up the John Lennon strip down that he did of Double Fantasy.
Yeah.
And so I'm with the producer. You know, the guy that recorded it, and we listened to John's vocals on the 10 31s and 1032s, and the Unities and the Super Rocks, and the vocal just has so much more body and so much more place and was so much closer to the way he said that he recorded it. So
there you go. Can't get a better endorsement than that.
Yeah, and I like the Genelecs, and they're what I'm used to, which is probably more important than anything else.
Right.
Like, that's what I'm used to.
Yep.
Are they the best speakers? I don't know, but I'm used to them, and
maybe
I like them.
They might be the best speakers for you.
Exactly.
So.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, Pro-X, I know Brower has Pro-X as well, doesn't he? And Neil Averon has Pro-X. A lot of guys love them.
Yeah, they work great.
Yeah.
They're a thing. I love the ATCs. I think they're fantastic speakers. I think having a mid-range driver dedicated to the vocal range is really, really important.
Yeah, smart.
They're great speakers. I've wanted those for a long time, and now that I have them, I'm very happy.
And are you mixing mainly from the Pro-X and referencing those?
I move all over the place.
Right, good. That makes sense. There's more gear over here,
yeah,
everybody.
There's more gear.
More gear.
That guy. This guy I use all the time.
Oh, God, I can't believe I missed that.
A Space Echo or a Chorus Echo.
Oh, those are great.
And since Pro Tools 12 has commit now, you know, you just insert it, get the sound you want, hit commit, you know, go get a coffee, come back. It's printed. It's done. Use it. It's great.
That's really
nice. Oh, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So what else?
The Fender Echo Reverbs.
Yes, I just got these. They're not working yet, but I'm curious. Apparently, the oil chamber that's in these, there's like a chamber. Apparently, in that chamber is a lot of things that will kill you. Like really, really bad chemicals. Like, don't open them. So I'm not going to open them. I'm going to let somebody else open them. So this is just, these are just my weird modulation effects stuff. Like, this is for ruining vocals. There's
I think you might
reverbs.
Actually have Brower beat.
No.
You're getting close for vocal effects stuff.
Well, maybe.
You and Joe Zook, you know, this is Joe Zook's thing.
Yeah, that thing is such a cool EQ.
Yeah. Yeah, so. That's... Yeah, I mean, it's yours, so you talk about it. I mean,
it's just a really weird. It's the very first 2BQ ever.
Yeah.
It just sounds really cool. Sounds really cool on bass. Sounds really cool on vocals.
The Blonder Tongue.
Yep. It's just weird.
The Blonder Tongue. I mean, just the name alone, and then the color scheme idea.
Yeah, so crazy.
Cold to yeah, absolutely crazy. Oh, level lock.
Yep, level lock. That's usually tracking. It just is sitting here because we just got back. But this is where we put all, that's for my motorcycle.
I'm looking at it going, battery tender?
Yeah.
And then...
this is fun. This is an old tape delay.
Oh, wow.
And you actually physically move the heads to move the delay time on the tape.
Yeah. That's fantastic.
Yeah. That sounds really weird and does really strange and random
stuff. Like a copycat
stuff.
Kind
yep.
of. Yeah. You know what? This is... you know what? We're going to jump around a bit. Let's go back to here. So
this is just garbage.
Just garbage stuff?
Yep.
Okay. This, and I'm completely going out of sequence, but I love the electric stuff.
Yeah, I do too.
I got turned on to this. They went out of business quite a few years ago,
yep.
didn't they? And I think they were prone to breakages and stuff like that because they're kind of cheapy and plastic. But they were inexpensive, and Dave McCracken is a good friend of mine who's a great guy in England. He does like Ian Brown records and stuff like that.
Cool.
You know? He's a keyboard player, so he just basically plays stuff and then just feeds it through here and just screws it up.
Yeah.
And Dave Jordan had a lot of these. Brian Colstrom, God rest his soul, had a whole bunch of this stuff, and they just used to screw things up.
Yeah.
Mess things up. Sorry. Yeah.
It's great for slap. It's great for weird stuff. It's really fun.
Yeah, awesome.
And if you're really motivated, you can actually hook it up to Pro Tools via MIDI, and you can dump all the front panel stuff into it. And so when you pull up your session, it'll just set the delay to where it was.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Very cool. And you can record any movement on that, and it'll record it into Pro Tools and then play it back.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So. That's really cool. PCM 42, yeah. Is that 42?
Yep.
Yep.
Classic delay.
Yeah, wonderful. Look at you with more freaking Dolby.
Okay, this goes into lead vocal land.
Yeah.
And there's a parallel on all of my lead vocals that have Dolby, that have Bedini Audio Spatial, that have Dimension D. Like all that stuff is in a parallel on my vocal chain.
I'm telling you, you and Michael, you should have a competition.
Yeah, we have issues. He has nicer hair. So these are just some gates for cleaning up some analog
And he
effects.
Loves cycling.
Yeah. this is a parallel on my bass chain.
Nice.
A BA25, which is an old tube limiter that will kill you if you stick your hand in it.
It looks like it would.
Another Calrec. This is a parallel on a vocal, too. This is another vocal
I love
parallel.
Calrec stuff.
I do, too.
Yeah, they're great.
Super underrated. Their mic pre's are fantastic.
Yeah, they're really incredible stuff. And then look, what's all the Behringer stuff on?
That's just noise gates for effects and stuff like that, just to keep them quiet.
Nice.
Yep.
Then over here, you've got all the SSL 6000 series stuff.
Yeah, those were that was one of a couple of these that were built, custom built for some film studio in Hollywood.
Yeah.
And they're just parallels. It's just a summing mixer.
Oh, nice.
Essentially. So it's a 4000 series summer.
What's this?
I pulled that out of a dumpster. It just looks cool.
Ah. At least you're honest.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, that's a secret weapon. I can't talk about it.
Yeah, it's a graphometric paralyzer.
These
things are the greatest slap.
This is the other secret weapon.
Yeah, those things are awesome. I use them every day.
Yep.
Fantastic.
You're the only other two people I know that use these. CLA has them, and Joe Perry has them in his studio.
Really?
Yeah, he uses them on guitars. Yeah, they just give them that slap.
They sound great on guitar, and they sound great on vocal.
Joe's a big Elvis fan. And, you know, he just loves everything with that kind of little slappy stuff. He loves it. Yeah. You should check out his studio one day. It's insane.
I'd love to.
He's one of those guys that just, like, he just has magic taste. I always tell this story. I'm going to tell it on camera. The Aerosmith guys will hate me for telling this story, but it's the truth. First day I met them all, Stephen pulls up on a trike, you know, with the skull
right.
And the thing. Pulls up on the trike. Brad, he's a driver. So Brad comes in like an AMG Mercedes, like a driver's car. So he comes in. Joey comes in an Audi R8. I think it was yellow. You know, so what you'd expect. Tom's conservative, great guy, comes in a Porsche Panamera. And the last person to arrive was Joe, and he pulled up in a, what's it called? Oh, I'm blanking on the name. God, I'm ruining the whole story.
We'll edit that in later.
It was what was Buick's early 70s muscle car?
That's a Chevy.
It's like the
like, like an old 442 or
It was like, I think it might have been a 442, yeah.
Huh.
But he pulls in like stock, like just original condition
lit. That's awesome.
And it was just like, you just saw all the differences in personality. So when you go to a studio, you look over and you're like, oh, so you got an 8028. So your console's an 8028. You got a Studer, and then you've got like the choice piece of every single piece of classic equipment that you'd want to own.
Cool.
And it's just like, and there's every nice mic that you want. And then you've got 400 of the best guitars you've ever seen. And then a couple of hundred of the best amps. It's just like, there's nothing surplus. It's all just like, oh, I want to. Oh, there it is.
Proper.
There it is.
That's funny.
He's just a man of taste. I don't know what it is. The thing about him as well, I'm waxing very lyrically about him. He's really smart. He's very bookish. You know, I think he's just one of those guys that reads and wants to know, and has more funds than we do.
Yeah, a lot more funds.
So the AccuVerb.
AccuVerb stereo spring. This is a favorite delay of mine. D5000 delay. I clip the signal going through it through this lexicon. It's got the same limiter in it that the PCM42 does.
Oh.
It kind of like stops it, helps the vocal like not go crazy. The delays stay consistent.
Puts
a little color in it. It's kind of fun.
Great.
Cooper Time Cube. I use that on everything.
Oh, yeah. Time Cube.
Great on guitars.
I use it on guitars.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, with Sardi, we'd use it on vocals all the time.
BX20 Spring, also great on guitars.
Oh, I used to have one of those. You have one of those in England, kept on the BBC.
Super fun. This is Richard. I bought that from Richard Dodd. It was broken. It's still broken. It sounds awesome. I'm really excited. And then just some effects, you know, Sony Reverb, Lexicon Reverbs, AMS Reverb.
Wow.
Just the fun old
good
stuff. Fun old stuff.
Yeah, wonderful stuff.
And that's it. This isn't mine. This is my
mastering
assistant is also a mastering engineer.
Yeah.
So this is the new Moog, like stereo, which
yeah.
is super fantastic. And he threw it in his mastering rack, and now he won't give it back.
We saw that in Winternam.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
It's great. It's
He's got some master lag.
Yep. So he does mastering. He'll drag that over into the between my speakers and master in here when I'm not working.
Oh, wow. That's fantastic. So,
and that's about, I mean, there's a EMT 140 tube plate in the back.
Oh, there is?
Which
and you're
is,
using that?
Oh, yeah. And that's it. You can't go into that room or we'll be here for like 3 hours.
Oh, dear.
This is all my tracking stuff.
Oh dear.
Yeah.
Yes.
It gets problematic.
All right, mate. That was amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you ever so much.
Thank you so much. So great to hang.
I know. It's great to do a part two and actually come here and not just see the bookshelves in the background. Are you saying that was Richard Dodd's idea?
Yeah. He said that we were talking about doing this room, and he said that he did this in Rick Rubin's place in Malibu, and it worked out really well, and it looks so much cooler than actual, like, fancy diffusion that I was just like, yeah, well, let's go for it.
Well, you know, he did Silverbird Laosea, so I'm happy.
Yeah.
I trust
him. He's a genius. Like, he's great. You should interview him, actually, because he's brilliant.
I know. I've got to try and fit some more time in. And is he still just living a couple doors down from Blackbird?
Working, not living.
Oh, yeah. But working. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he had his place there. I remember he mastered a record for me a while ago, and the A&R guy went down there, and I think he said, I hadn't been to his studio, he said he was like mastering on like speakers.
He has these big electrostatics too, but it's not, his room is not set up to impress people.
Exactly.
Because he impresses people with the sound.
Exactly.
Not the way it looks. So.
And the A&R guy was like, I didn't think.
Whatever. It's all good.
No, I know. But that's what we're here to talk about. It's like, you know, I say all the time, if it sounds good.
It is good.
It is good. And that's really all that matters.
Yep.
But there's a lot of dogma.
Yeah. Just ignore it.
Yeah, exactly. Ignore it. So thanks very much, mate.
And thank Appreciate you. It's good to see you, Warren.
Good to see you. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing. Please leave a bunch of questions and comments below. And if there's any really good ones, I'll hit up Reid and get him to answer them. Have a marvelous time recording.